I wanted the perfect meal. I also wanted, to be absolutely frank, Colonel Walter E. Kurtz, Lord Jim, Lawrence of Arabia, Kim Philby, the Consul, Fowler, Tony Poe, B. Traven, Christopher Walken. I wanted to be one of those debauched heroes and villains out of Graham Greene, Joseph Conrad, Francis Coppola, and Michael Cimino. I wanted to wander the world in a dirty seersucker suit getting into trouble. I wanted adventures. I wanted to go up the Nung River to the heart of darkness in Cambodia. I wanted to ride out into a desert on camelback, sand and dunes in every direction, eat whole roasted lamb with my fingers. I wanted to kick snow off my boots in a mafia nightclub in Russia. I wanted to play with automatic weapons in Phnom Penh, recapture the past in a small oyster village in France, step into a seedy, neon-lit pulqueria in rural Mexico. I wanted to run roadblocks in the middle of the night, blowing past angry militia with a handful of hurled Marlboro packs, experience fear, excitement, wonder. I wanted kicks, the kind of melodramatic thrills and chills I'd yearned for since childhood, the kind of adventure I'd found as a little boy in the pages of my Tintin comic books. I wanted to see the world. And I wanted the world to be just like the movies.
I've had something of a multi-decade obsession with the Congo. It's been kind of a personal dream, if you will, to travel the Congo River. And now, for better or worse, I get that chance. We've rented a trusty vessel, and I shall dub thee the Captain Willard. All right, did you maggots load the chickens?
Today I'm feeling very Klaus Kinski. A mile south, just across the river from Belém, it's another world, an older one.
Haben die Chivaros bestimmt einem der Missionare, die sie umgebracht haben, abgenommen.
Seltsam.
Scheint deine letzte Warnung zu sein. Die Nacktarsche lieben blumige Gesten. Ich wünschte, sie würden sich mal zeigen.
The boundaries of Ranomafana Park protect what they can of Madagascar's rapidly diminishing rainforest.
But it's not all about lemurs and rare species and unspoiled beautiful places.
These are the Tanala people. These are the people of the forest. This is the fifth time they've had to change the location of the village because they do slash and burn agriculture. This ceremony today is a ceremony to celebrate the fact that 17 people from the village of Mbatalahe are going to donate their land to conservation. It won't be cut down.
Before the Tanala land can officially become a part of the park, the gods, the ancestors, somebody must be appeased. And that, as it often does, means something must die.
Seen this a lot?
I usually don't go when this is happening.
Wow.
For someone with as dark a worldview, judging from his films anyway, as the newly vegetarian Mr. Aronofsky, he seems unusually uncomfortable with the bleeding realities of local custom.
You see him?
Preferring instead to trip the light fantastic in the rainforest idol.
Yeah.
Very tight.
Right? Very.
So how important is it to put you up in something that makes that works for you?
We're all movie fans. We're all people who understand that we're lucky, that the degree of freedom that we have to do what we want and shoot what we want. Everybody on my crew understands that if they have an idea, like I'd like to tell this story backwards, or I'd like to shoot this entire show, an entire episode on a cell phone, or black and white, or Panavision, or 16 millimeter film, let's make that happen. I will support that, and I work, thankfully, in an environment where the people around me will support that. So to the extent that it is possible for everybody to be creatively satisfied and try the things they always wanted to try, we're all in that together. You know, but you know, you have to have, you work with me, and most of the people I work with have worked with me for a very long time. I mean, some of the shooters on my show have been with me 15 years. Chris and Lydia, who own 0.0, the production company, they were my original camera people on my first show for Food Network. They used to walk backwards together on their honeymoon in front of me with these little Panasonic cameras through like minefields in Cambodia, just them. Still with them. I've never made television with anybody else. Got to have a sense of humor, got to love movies, got to know your cinematographers, because if I, you know, start talking about Vittorio Storaro, you don't know who the fuck I'm talking about, we're going to have a problem. You know, work hard. I don't have to give a pep talk. Everybody understands that we all expect of each other to do our best work every episode. To be different, to be more outrageous, to be different, and to be better. And the people who take that challenge seriously do well on my show and stick around. And the ones who turn in competent work do not. Because I abhor competent work. What about the most fun show?
Oh, we gotta say Rome here, come on.
I think Rome is a really fun show.
Rome is the show that I'm most proud of.
That's an amazing show.
Because we did, it all started out with, I think, this group. We're all sitting around in a hotel lobby somewhere, talking about films we like and how we could do you know, I think the driving mission of this show is that whatever worked last week, whatever we did last week, no matter how well it was received, how successful it was, how the ratings were, how much people loved it, whatever we're going to do next week, we want to try really, really hard to undermine completely what we did last week. Mm-hmm. We want to present a moving target. We don't want ever for the network to be able to say, mm-hmm. I think I figured out what the hell it is that you guys are doing. Let's do more of that. Because mm-hmm. by the time they figure that out, we will have moved on mm-hmm. to something else. So we spent a lot of time sitting around, having a few cocktails, thinking, what is the most fucked up thing we can do? Mm-hmm. And I don't know which one of you guys said, let's do a food show mm-hmm. all in black and white.
Yeah.
That's yeah. how good we are. We can make food porn in black and white. And when we started talking about, then we started talking about early neorealist Italian films that, you know, 1% of our audience might have seen. And we went out and did just about the stupidest thing you could do on you know, on travel and food. We made it all black and white show, yeah. lit. We never light, but nah. we lit.
Yeah, they said no way. They said that was impossible.
My proudest moment, because it was just so stupid. And it looks yeah. so beautiful. And the work you guys did, and the editing, and the music.
I never knew Vienna before the war, with its Strauss music, its glamour, and its easy charm. That's the opening line from The Third Man, one of my favorite films. It depicts a Vienna of 50 years ago. And is the only Vienna I really know. One of the more famous scenes from film history happened here. The Reisenrath Ferris wheel at the Prater. Orson Welles and Joseph Cotten. Film, The Third Man.
Oldest Ferris wheel in operation. That's troubling. That is not an encouraging sound. I'm feeling that right in my calves. It would be sort of cool if this thing, like, one end snapped off. I don't think we'd make it. So what's the line in the movie? Orson Welles playing Harry Lime agreed to meet his old friend, Holly Martins, at the Prater. Take the Ferris wheel up. And up top, in a rather menacing fashion, he slides the door open, which, shockingly, you're not allowed to do. And he looks down and he gives that little famous speech. He's, look down there, Holly. What do they look like? They look like ants. If I gave you all this money, would you really care if one of those ants stopped moving?
I didn't even think about death. But shooting actually those Russian tanks, you know, going through that. They can shoot me. Anybody who had a camera was shot immediately by a Russian soldier. That time, I didn't think about that. But I felt that I had to photograph it.
You were alive and holding a camera at a very important time in history. You had to think, I'm doing something important.
It's very easy to make beautiful pictures. But pictures which mean something, with what's in it. But that's a totally different story.
You know these images. You grew up with them. They're burned into your brain. They're iconic sequences. Framed and lit and seen through the lens in ways that changed filmmaking forever. All made by the same man. So, who made these beautiful things? Where did he come from? It didn't begin in Hollywood. It began here, in the streets of Budapest. What about his life? His past, his upbringing, led him again and again to look through a piece of glass and make images like these. But first, some context.
Both parents loved films, and this was really important. I grew up in a house, what I thought was typical for the 60s, filled with books, a library with many, many books, many good books, but a lot of them illustrated. Collections of books about films with very enticing stills of films that I hadn't seen as a small child, but very much wanted to after I saw these, you know, sort of sexy, violent, dark, interesting images. Also, magazines, historical magazines, Horizons, and there were a number of others that were basically hardbound magazines filled with beautiful images. Those really got me thinking a lot. You know, my parents, the importance that books played in my house to my parents obviously carried on to me, and that love of film also. My father later went to work at Willoughby's Camera Store as the audio in their audio department. And back then you could rent, at Willoughby's they would rent 16 millimeter projectors and films, and they had quite an extraordinary collection of films. This at a time when they didn't have videotapes or any of this, they're downloadable. So my parents would regularly have little dinner parties, they'd invite friends over, and they'd play something like Treasure of Sierra Madre or a classic film downstairs for their friends. And then to keep all the rotten kids happy, they'd, you know, there'd be like a Western or a monster film upstairs. But what I would do very early on, I'd hear the adults downstairs, and it seemed like that movie was more interesting. And often I would demand to see that this Treasure of Sierra Madre. And I think my father in particular was so passionate about films that he never denied me if I said I want to see it, even if it was way beyond my appropriate age. I mean, I went to see Midnight Cowboy at age 12 because it sounded awesome. He couldn't resist some films he loved so much he couldn't wait to show me. You know, as a dad, you can never be too young for Mel Brooks, in his view, or Stanley Kubrick. So, you know, I think I saw Dr. Strangelove, like, as it came out. I was a little kid. You know, it's a film about nuclear apocalypse. We're all going to die, Dad? You know, yes. It's going to be really hilarious. So those made an impression, and it was an impression. Fortunately, in those times, Channel 13 PBS would regularly show the Criterion and Janus film collections. So those have a sort of a magical place in my personal history. Sitting alone in my room, probably after I should have been asleep, turning on the TV and watching these wonderful, not appropriate for my age, films, you know, Bergman and Antonioni, Fellini. I'd pretty much seen the entire Criterion collection by the time I was 12. So I was a well familiar with films by the time I was, you know, in high school, and passionate about them. They were that form of words and images meant something to me. There was real power to them.
La Boca, this neighborhood, is very Italian. They say that this is where tango was born, in this little street two blocks away here called Caminito.
And where does that come from? Emotionally, the need for tango, why here?
Tango is extremely sad. It's about love, about despair, it's about poverty. And the dance, I think, is one of the most elegant dances in the world, you know, where they barely move and suddenly they stop. When they stop, you know, you tremble because you feel that the man is sort of inside of her almost. And then he goes on.
Are there moments where you can relax, breathe easy, and say, yeah, you know, I've done something with my life. I'm in a beautiful place. I'm back where my people came from. Life is good. You ever have one of those? I'm asking for myself.
What I feel is that I never was a person. I didn't want to be one of those old guys like, you know, oh, I wish I had done this. I wish I had done that. I wish I had done that. I can honestly say I got to do this, I got to do that, I got to make movies, I got to take big chances with the movies, I got to be in the wine business, I got to see my children be in the movie business. I'm going to be so busy saying all the things that I got to do that when I die, I'm not going to notice it. I really don't have any regrets. Many people are worried about making this move and not making this move. In the end, do what you love, because that's the secret of life.
No reservations on Travel Channel to Parts Unknown on CNN, and it's a pretty spectacularly evolving show. I mean, do you have a process, like send out homework to the team beforehand and say, watch this and just think?
Yeah, it's usually often cinematography. It's either issue driven, something that I'm pissed off about or really interested in, or personality driven, meaning there's somebody I really want to work with who I've given an opportunity to collaborate with, whether it's Josh Homme from Queens of the Stone Age, or we know somebody who's uniquely positioned with a voice and a story in an interesting location. But often it's just I see a film, or I'm already familiar with a film. Often it's that the cinematography really captures me, and we'll all watch the same movie on assignment, kind of, and then we go out and try to do that.
Years ago, when I first watched the stunningly beautiful films of director Wong Kar-wai, it shaped forever the way I'd see Hong Kong. From that point on, my hopes, my expectations of this city would be seen through that lens, a lens that was in nearly every case pointed by, focused by, this man. Christopher Doyle, longtime resident of Hong Kong, known by his Mandarin name, Duke Feng. His earlier works with Wong Kar-wai were distinguished by unspeakably gorgeous images of beautiful people moving through spaces both unfamiliar and yet painfully intimate, alternately jagged, frenzied, innovative, languid, composed, chaotic. I obsessed over his work, fetishized it, longed to see Hong Kong like the characters in so many of his films longed for each other. And I feared, like those characters, I would be denied. I was wrong.
I mean, you do understand the impulse, right? People see work that you've long ago, like, moved on from, and they get, they get a hard on, and it won't go away. I mean, come on,
But the great pleasure is, I did it, and it's done. You want me to reshoot Chongqing Express?
But of course, they all do, don't they?
I don't know how I did it.
Now, our job as artists is to show you the world that you think you know and celebrate it. In my wonderful experience and wonderful journey with a person called Wong Kar-wai, but finally, after all the films we made a film called In the Mood for Love. I think everything we did before then was preparation. I think that's it. If you find this in your life, you actually say one sentence, or you make one dish, or you make one image that is true, that's pretty good, because not many people get that.
This is very religious site. It's called the Burning Lake.
Burning Lake or Burning River?
The Burning Lake, but I think it's actually a river.
I see people are leaving prayer flags and these things.
These are called sasas, these offerings. Sometimes they're made out of clay, and sometimes they're made out of actually the ashes of the dead.
Whoa.
Wow, that's pretty awesome.
It's beautiful.
A little pile of incense. Where do you think this country is headed?
Honestly, I don't know what I believe. I don't know if it's good or bad. It seems like Shangri-La, Like for the place that invented gross national happiness, they're contented under $2 a day.
Yes.
I don't want my child herding yak, and I don't know that a lot of parents do, even here.
Having a fully paved road across this country's going to be a very, very different place in 5 years. The question is, do they stay committed to happiness and not to consumption?
Ooh.
Getting off the plane, when we got here, there were many flat-screen TVs.
First comes electricity, then comes a television, then come pop stars and materialism. But maybe that's arrogant. Maybe that's just, you know, easy for me to say.
I don't know. A lot of the people we talk to, there's a tremendous amount of respect of what they have. We're finally seeing the effects of climate change in a terrifying way, which they're all going to be able to witness on their flat-screen TVs. You know, I think people are going to really hold on to treasures like this.
I know it's beautiful. I'm glad it hasn't been dumped yet by the world.
Echoes of lives lived, lives lost. No other city has been repeatedly so powerful, then fallen so low. Few other cities have been so shaped by individual imaginations, either brilliantly creative or unspeakably evil. Start again, start again. Look back at the past, never forget it. Like an Irish playwright said, you must go on, I can't go on, I'll go on.